van harte welkom bij dit tweede debat naar aanleiding van de 50ste verjaardag van het SIM. Can Matrix Save the Matrix? Vandaag kijken we dus naar wat er allemaal beweegt op het vlak van mediastudies en mediacurrencies. Dat is de ruilvoet in zaken het bereik van reclameruimte die gehanteerd wordt door reclameregies en mediaagentschappen. Pour ce deuxième débat, je suis accompagnée par le directeur du CIM, Steph Peters. Et dans la première partie de l'émission, nous nous focalisons sur ce qui se passe au niveau international. Steph, you've invited a number of international colleagues. Can you tell us who they are and why you invited them?
Yes, I've indeed invited some colleagues from the UK, from France, from Germany, from the Netherlands, and also a few representatives from countries similar to us in market size or structure. Sweden and Switzerland. They do not all work on the same media types, but their experiences is undoubtedly interesting for us. Mm-hmm. So with us today are Magnus Anselm from MMS Sweden, Olaf Lassalle from AGMA Germany, Jella Hoffmann from WEMF Switzerland, Johan Smit from PMA Netherlands. And two people I spoke earlier because they couldn't be present at this moment in time, Justin Sampson from Barb UK and Julien Rosanvallon, de Médiamétrie France. There's a lot of going on in the world of classic and online television. Magnus, MMS announced last May the launch of its online video currency based on a mix of panel data and census online video data. A major step forward, does that include also the measurement of online advertising?
Yes, it does. We've actually had online advertising in our online video currency since 2014, and so it's been a long time. And then in 2017, we launched it through modeling together with the linear TV advertising. So that's taken for granted in our market. They've been used to it for a while.
Which brings us to the next challenge, measuring non-linear video. What about video on demand or dynamic ad insertion?
We've included that earlier on too. For example, the telcos, when they have different apps distributing advertising, that is also included. It's reported, integrated.
I talked about Total TV earlier with Julien and Justin. Let's have a look. Gentlemen, thanks for being with us. You are both heavily involved in the measurement of what we call total video. Julien, Médiamétrie was one of the first to measure all screens. Did you succeed in finding a common currency for classic TV and online video?
Yes, hello, Steph. We actually did come up with what we call the video GRP. And the video GRP was, in fact, what we call duration-weighted impressions. So the metric was, in fact, not widely used. First of all, because it was not present in our TV plus online tool called XCR. But most importantly, because we did not succeed in clearly defining what should be total video. Is YouTube part of the total video? Is total video only within the TV assets? So there are still many questions to be answered, in particular in terms of defining the scope of what we call total video.
Okay, it's a never-ending story, isn't it? Justin, last June, Barb announced its research plan till 2029, which is quite a far horizon for most joint industry committees. What are the most remarkable innovations we can expect from Barb?
There are two big innovations in the panel we've commissioned. Firstly, we've got the largest ever increase in reporting sample to 7,000 homes. That's close to 16,000 individuals. And we're introducing new TV set meters, which feature an original avatar-based registration system, which we believe will be more engaging for panel members. But we will have more innovation even sooner than these innovations in our new panel, which will start in 2024. And the new innovation is that we are on the verge of a once-in-a-generation upgrade in our reporting, and we will soon be on a daily basis publishing audience data for streaming services such as Netflix, Disney Plus, and YouTube. These data are generated through a meter that tracks streaming activity on the home's router, and we're also using audio matching to collect SVOD program ratings.
But in practice, there will be many challenges. Will they be essentially methodological, financial, or political, you think?
In the first instance, we have a logistical challenge. Can we get the refresh panel up and running by 2024? Kantar has to install new metering technology across the existing panel before extending the panel size by almost 40%. And this has to be done in the context of continued uncertainty caused by the public health crisis and other macro issues. But from a financial perspective, we've got the security of confirmed funding now until the end of the decade. I think we also have to consider the current initiative from advertisers for cross-media measurement in line with the WFA's ambitions. In that context, we have to ensure that any use of BARB data in the solution that's put in place is safeguarded by the knowledge that there are objectively equivalent inputs from other data sources and that the integrity of our data is preserved in any output. So in that context, there is a methodological challenge with significant political undercurrents.
Julien, last June, Médiamétrie published a press release on the positive audit of your online video measurement, and the release mentioned your collaboration with YouTube. Did you succeed to break the walled garden and to measure their content, or are you limited to using their own sampled and aggregated data?
Oh. First of all, in our vision, it's important that we can bring an accurate vision of the, we were mentioning the total video big picture. And within this total video big picture, we know the importance of YouTube. So yes, we have developed a methodology where we use some data coming from YouTube, but we're also leveraging our panel. And the system that we use to produce those numbers is a hybrid system. We are not limited to YouTube. YouTube was a first important step, of course, but we are now also measuring the Dailymotion platform, the platform from Vivendi, and we are also including the details of the largest content ecosystem on this platform. So it's a move, and hopefully we'll be able to aggregate more platforms and more content providers in the coming months.
Now you are making me jealous. Time to change the subject. That was my cue for the second question. Are today's measurement solutions future-proof? Olaf, AGMA measures about all media except for television. Did the COVID year 2020 shake your confidence in some of our well-established recruitment methods and their representativeness?
Not really, to be honest, right away in the beginning. The corona pandemic has triggered or caused changes in all areas of society. We at AGMA, we reacted to this with a short-term special analysis. For example, we were able to provide current data on the increased use of newspaper and magazines, or show that web radio usage increased by more than 20%, actually. The most obvious challenge, definitely, as you can imagine, was the classic face-to-face interviews or surveys. We changed the portion of online interviews and face-to-face interviews dramatically, and actually we will perceive that. But more important was how much is the corona pandemic, the effect on corona pandemic to out-of-home surveys. Corona, will it happen, and will definitely change our way in conducting the service on the out-of-home field? Well, as I told you already, the online interviews has increased a lot. But nevertheless, Kate Carty, the telephone interviews will definitely be an important pillar in our kind of service. So actually, it has not affect our, well, the quality of the different methodologies, but actually the portion of the different kinds of methodologies has changed dramatically and will probably stay in the post-corona time.
Thank you, clear. Jelle, we consider research in Belgium as complicated. Our two language groups, we always apply identical methods, but they rarely react to it in the same way. How do you manage representativeness and comparability between German, French, and Italian-speaking Swiss?
What we do is actually the same as you do. We treat them from the method point of view as equal as possible. That is, we have the same questions, of course. We have native speaker as interviewers. And we as well have call centers in different language-speaking parts of the country, so to manage that. But I think what is quite important as well, we see that there are actually differences in the three language parts of the country. We have differences in culture. We have a completely different media landscape. We have a difference even in social demographic structure. For example, the Italian-speaking region is on average like 3 or 4 years older than the French-speaking part. So finally, we accept differences. We know that there are differences, so we not only try to nivellate them, but we accept them as well.
Okay, I have a question for all of you. There's a tendency to integrate proprietary data in media audience studies. Logfile data in radio, ad server data in digital, proprietary sensor data in digital out of home, proprietary logs from international or local, for that matter, walled gardens. What is your take on this evolution towards a mix of independent and proprietary data? What is acceptable, what isn't? Johan, you represent the agencies in the Netherlands. What is your opinion on this?
Well, whether you want to accept it or not, it will be used by agencies and also by advertisers who have in-house certain capabilities. So it's not a matter of whether you work with that or not. The point is that you have different standards, I would say. So the easiest to agree on a data set is between an individual client and agency. Then it will be for the whole agency and all its clients. And then the highest level, of course, will be when you talk about a jig. And this is also referring to an earlier question you had about how future-proof is what we're doing. I believe that we will see that next to delivering or governing the data collection, there will also be a role for the governing bodies to validate data. And then you will have data which is validated by an independent body, and that can be used by agencies or advertising media owners.
I agree with you, Johan. We see the same thing, and we've actually started also to handle first-party data. So if we were working or still work with a hybrid solution between the TAM data and the census data, we move towards a one dimension more in the hybrid, actually. The big problem as we speak is something that you touched on, Johan. It is it's much, much harder to get the whole picture when we get first party data like that. So we need to build bridges kind of between the industry data and the priority data.
I definitely agree with Magnus and Johan. Well, in the past at ECMA, we were totally reluctant to use these external data. But right now we have to adopt it because like all of the agencies, all of our member agencies are working with this different data and we have to adopt to it. So we have to find out, is the quality high enough to fusion it, to merge it with our currency data or is it not? We have to validate them and then we have to find intelligent ways to merge these things.
Okay, so the future is hybrid also at the level of different data sources. Let me allow to introduce a third theme: are our organizations future-proof? Jelle, I stay with you. A joint industry committee that is not directly involved in television or online research is often not the most popular kid in class. Yet from a distance, WEMF seems immune to this diminishing appeal. What's your secret?
I was afraid that you would ask that, actually. Well, I could say that we are not only doing print, or I could as well say we are not immune to that, but that would be probably the boring answer. In Switzerland, we, the WEMF, is also very active in the field of cross-media data. So we have the largest and the one and only, actually, cross-media strategic data set in combination with the largest consumer survey, so actually the target group information survey, and they are still very attractive. I think the other very important point is that WEMF has always been and will be in the future very keen on innovating and diversifying. And so we have several activities and projects. For example, we are doing digital out-of-home certification, or another example. So this fall, we will integrate social media platform data in our strategic data set. Or a third example, we are very active in the tooling sector. So we are not only providing the planning tools for print and cinema, but we are as well very active to integrate other data set in our data platform. And just now we did a very large step in backward integration by investing in the software company that is actually providing our tools.
Johan, Jelle talks about innovation. In the Netherlands, you took innovation to the next level. The future started in last April when you announced the official birth of the Nationaal Media Onderzoek. It took several years and a lot of your patience to reach an agreement between all stakeholders. Can you tell us what inspired this effort and why it was so difficult to find a consensus?
It wasn't so much inspiration, it was more lack of money. We all agreed that the way forward was too costly if we would continue doing what we're doing now. So if you look at the end result, like for like, we had a saving of over 20%. And then you see what's happening. That immediately the savings are used to increase demands and requests. And that you can call innovation. Of course, the biggest issue is a fear of new things. It's very difficult for people to understand what it will mean. And you just ask if the current situation is future-proof. I think if you want to have a cross-media planning and reporting tool, JIGs are not working anymore. I know that all has to do with politics and finance, so money and power. And I think that what actually made it work, first of all, we made a lot of mistakes, or we took steps which didn't work. But none of these steps were a waste of money or time. In the end, they all helped to get us to where we are now. And what actually literally helped us, and it's an overused word now, is the storytelling. What we did is try to explain to the stakeholders how great the research was. And of course, that's fine, but most of the board members are not on a daily basis occupied with the methodology of research, of audience measurement. So when we changed the narrative from, let's say, the content on how brilliant the design was, and I can easily say brilliant because it wasn't my design, it was the four JIG directors who did this, but how brilliant the design was, and we changed that to how useful it was for the stakeholders to have different data sets, and also to make them understand that there are benefits also financially. If you have linear streams included and reported, it's just extra GRP inventory. Just a simple example. Using every silo is measured in different ways, on different platforms with different meters or meterings. That's nice, but only when people get the benefits of that for their business, knowing that you can actually see the radio and TV and online behavior without too much modeling, then it makes sense. And of course, we had to harmonize the questionnaires and stuff like that, but nobody's interested of the stakeholders. What's an establishment survey? Why is it necessary? So when we left that path and went to the business, that actually helped people say yes.
I always say to my stakeholders, they've done the easy part in the Netherlands and now starts the difficult part. Magnus, a question to you. For a medium-sized market, MMS is a pretty big TV joint industry committee. You are heavily involved from data collection to software exploitation. You handle, I think, 6 research partners. Can joint industry committees like us stay in control of research solutions? Or will the medium and small-sized joint industry committees become the account managers for the international solution providers?
That depends on what we do, actually. When we move towards, we've been trying to get one solution with one vendor, but that hasn't been available, actually. So that's the reason why we've been working with five for a while. But now we're moving towards actually one integrated solution with Nielsen, but then adding on some modeling in the last step. I think actually that we're moving towards another rule that Johan touched on, and I think Jella did it too. It's to be validating. We've been quality controlling all the logs and things like that for 15 years now. So that's one reason why we're a big JIC, even though we just handle TV and online video. But anyway, I think actually moving towards working with fewer vendors would decrease the demand, but on the other hand, we will probably need more to validate all the first-party data that we start receiving. But in our scope is also TikTok, it's Facebook, it's Instagram.
Okay, thank you. Johan, I come back to you. One of the key features in the NMO effort is the collaboration between research institutes that used to be fierce competitors up till now. Why do you think that would work?
I still believe they are fierce competitors, and I think we have to make a distinction between, let's say, the people who are on the ground. Not too long ago, we had a lunch with both Kantar and Ipsos operational people and the people from our side, explaining how we would like to work together. And that's actually the easy part. But it took a while for boardrooms to agree that they could work together, which makes sense because there is the fierce competition worldwide. In many countries, once you have the contract, there's no competition left for the remaining period of the contract. So what we found that is taking time, understandable. But for instance, we have agreed with Kantar and Ipsos and NMO together that for the handling of the data, we will be joint controllers. For both Kantar and Ipsos, that was a whole new situation. Normally, they are the processors and the JIC is the controller. Since there's so much integration in their work and the work we do and the demands we have, we decided that the joint controller agreement would be the best option. And that means that all three of us are working together now. That took a bit longer than I anticipated to organize that, but now everybody's really happy with that. So it takes some time to get used to by all parties, but it is definitely doable as long as you have clear guidelines on what you expect. And of course, we have a charter between Kantar and Ipsos on how they work together.
I would like to introduce our last theme, being the future of our currencies. Jella, press is traditionally strong in Switzerland. How do you handle press sites and apps in your press currencies? Will Total Brand become the new press currency?
I don't know if total brand will be actually the new press currency. As you said, print is quite strong in Switzerland still. It's, by the way, it's larger than TV in ad revenue still. So I think there will be a print currency for some years. But we have a total audience, we call the product, a total brand readership product as well, where we combine print readership figures with the official online figures from the online chick. And we do that via Fusion. But actually right now we have a stopover phase. We have a reviewing phase as we are getting a new online currency in Switzerland. And what we learned during the last month when we were talking to clients and stakeholders of that product, that this actually total audience product has been used mainly for marketing issues, for marketing reasons, and for strategic planning, but it was actually not used by agencies for tactical planning, as the planning modes, the planning logic is completely different in online and in print. And so we are right now discussing with our clients in what way we will do this total audience, this total brand product in the future. We know we will do one, but perhaps it's not that sophisticated, or it's not that complicated, and it will perhaps not be on the tactical level.
Okay, thank you. It sounds a bit familiar to us also. I asked Julien and Justin also a question on currencies in total video. Let's hear what they had to say about it. Julien, one question on radio. Your radio study today is a traditional telephonic recall on yesterday's listening behavior, which is very different from the sophisticated total video measurement. How does the French market perceive this difference between currencies?
Well, the reality is that we are in the middle of a major change in the radio measurement. So I'm saying in the middle because last summer we decided to fully transform the shape and form of our CATI survey. It's more fluid, an easier to operate CATI survey that still will allow us to have a very significant and important number of surveys. So that was the first very important step of the transformation. And we are currently discussing with the market, and we have a rendezvous in the coming weeks to see if the radio market agrees with using the automatic portable people meter system that we use for TV for the out-of-home measurement. And we have been testing for more than 2 years now, and we are now offering to the market, to the radio market, to use it in a hybrid system for, in particular, for the media planning and for behavioral studies.
Interesting. Justin, also on the topic of currency, but for total video, you explained earlier your plans for the rest of the decade, and you mentioned also the ISBA initiative. Do you think you can preserve the total video currencies with the arrival of the new kind of GDPR-proof big data exchanges between media and advertisers?
I think the current initiative from the WFA, which is being implemented here in the UK by ISBA, is driven by advertisers being concerned at the historical lack of industry standards in online measurement, despite their interactions with the online platforms in terms of data exchange. To me, this shows the tide is moving in favour of joint industry measurement. So I think we should be optimistic about the future of our currencies. But that said, we do need to coexist with the direct data exchanges that will become increasingly common between broadcasters and advertisers. Here in the UK, the proportion of commercial impacts reported by Barb, which are part of the agreed trading currency, has been declining gradually for many years, whether it be audiences for sponsorship bumpers, ads seen more than 7 days after transmission, or Sky AdSmart, which is a dynamically inserted advertising proposition. We report commercial impacts for planning purposes rather than trading purposes, and this trend will continue. So the currencies need to coexist with other data sources, and a big initiative here in the UK is the collaboration of commercial broadcasters on the delivery of C-Flight as a means of reporting BVOD, broadcaster VOD, campaign performance alongside linear campaigns. And that solution is heavily reliant on BARB data. But we are becoming increasingly involved in actually working on C-Flight and providing assurance to the industry on the integrity of the solution, with BARB reviewing and auditing the solution. Now, whether this extends to total video or not depends on the participation of the online platform. We don't at the moment see a total video currency, but we do see a very bright future for currencies working like BARB, working alongside the big data exchanges between advertisers and media owners.
And on this positive note, I would like to thank you both for your participation. I still do have a last question for the four of you. Justin seems optimistic, but is the creation of reach and frequency data still our future, or should we look for other means to establish credibility in media? Who wants to go first?
Yes, so actually, I think reach and frequency will still be there for a while. That is like the traditional currency studies or surveys. But I think they will be less important in the future. On the other hand, I think that chicks like them, for example, they will do more certification and more validation of external data, of third party, of hybrid models, of algorithms, and so on. I think we have a great competence in that field, and we can provide that to the market. And I think the other thing where I see a big chance for us is the field of strategic information. There will still, there will always be a need to know where target groups are, to know what they do and how you can reach them. And even if you don't use data for tactical planning, you will always need some information and valid data for strategic planning still. So that's what I think.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Yes, with the disclaimer that I'm not really good at predicting the future. I think as long as there are clients who need mass markets and are basically depending on branding, and there's still a few of them out there, we will need reach and frequency. It's the butter and bread of what they do. It's also the butter and bread of what the agencies do. So I think, but let's say for the foreseeable future, reach and frequency will remain important. Nevertheless, I think there might be differences. We talked about this earlier, about the validation. Like Jelle is saying, there are other things, but I think we should definitely avoid the X going to look to expand their business just to stay in business, because in the end, the jigs are there for the advertisers and the media owners, and that's their role. If there's no longer a demand from advertisers and media owners, then that's the end of the jigs.
First of all, I agree with both Jelle and Johan, but kind of in different ways, and also Justin, it's going to be a side by side reality, and for different purposes, and the validation role to play will be more and more important, I think, almost like an auditor, a daily auditor of the quality. But something that you mentioned, Johan, I think it's really really important. It's more and more of performance marketing, and the performance marketing, we are not fast enough, I think. So lots of that validating how you perform, it will be a lot of first party data. While when you go to the branding part, I still think reach and frequency will be really, really important.
Olaf, that leaves the last word to you.
Well, I basically agree with all the different opinions. We haven't talked about technical measurements. This will increase as far as ACMA is concerned, will increase in the near future, definitely. So we need technical measurements, but we always need the demographics. And we still get the demographics only like by interviews, by surveys, just like we got them from the REACH data. So actually it will play an important role, maybe a different role.
Okay, thank you all. I think what we heard is European Joint Industry Committees saying they will be there in the future, their role will be changing, but they are ready to innovate. Olaf, Jella, Magnus, and who was the last one? Johan, not to forget. Thank you so much for sharing your insight and see you around soon. Bye.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you. Congratulations.
Yeah, congratulations. Yeah. It's impressive.
50 years of shame.
Yes.
Oké, fantastisch gedaan, Stef. Hartelijk dank. Ik denk dat we een aantal boeiende en vooruitstrevende zaken gehoord hebben van onze buitenlandse collega's. En we willen u nu toch even aftoetsen bij ons panel van eigen bodem. Voilà, il est temps donc d'accueillir nos panélistes sur le plateau.
Advertising space. There are so many advertising spaces left, if only you're willing to see them. And talking about space, how about this? Space. The ultimate marketeer. You put your ad on a space rocket and reach the real unserved audience out there. Why limit your message to mere earthlings? Don't just think outside the box, think outside the globe, mate. It's amazing. Go where no man has ever gone before. You take your billboard, you wrap it up.
You can keep inventing new media.
Or you can use the existing ones smarter. Ads and data.
We unwaste.
At GfK, knowledge is our currency. We track over 180 million products and process trillions of data points for our clients. If you know exactly when you need to know, then you can move with conviction. At GfK, we know.
When life comes to a grinding halt, and yet everything changes so rapidly, we put the spotlight on the important issues that move us every day to help you adjust, to lift your spirits.
It's our responsibility to make this world a better place.
And to support the right causes, because television makes a difference.
Engage.
Tim van Doorslaar van DPG Media, ook Gert Kallewaert van Ipsos, Marco Marini, de RTL IP, Stefan Hermans van GfK et last but not least, nous accueillons Bernard Kools de Space. Je voudrais d'abord commencer par vous, Marco Marini. Qu'est-ce qui vous a frappé le plus dans ce qu'on a entendu dans le discours des internationaux?
La question qui m'interpelle le plus, c'est toute la question autour de la data. C'est le mot sans doute qui a été le plus prononcé. Hein. Mm-hmm. Et c'est comment elle va intervenir demain dans le futur des mesures d'audience. Il y a 15 ou 20 ans, on parlait de big data, hein, comme d'un gros mot, quelque chose qui était un petit peu chaotique, confus, on avait du mal à maîtriser. Alors aujourd'hui, on a fait pas mal de chemin, je pense, dans toutes nos sociétés. Et aujourd'hui, on commence à maîtriser la chose. On a fait beaucoup de cleaning de data, donc du nettoyage, parce qu'il faut la nettoyer, cette data. Et on a commencé à mettre ça dans des tableaux, dans des dashboards qui donnent aujourd'hui, je vais dire, un semblant de données structurées. Mais il y a encore pas mal de boulot à faire.
Un semblant.
Je dirais un semblant parce qu'en fait, on fait chacun ça dans nos sociétés, chacun de son côté, avec chacun ses propres règles. Il n'y a pas d'harmonisation. C'est peut-être quelque chose justement dont il faudra parler pour le CIM.
Oui.
Et souvent, même dans chaque société, ça reste encore une boîte noire que seuls quelques data scientists maîtrisent vraiment. Et je pense que demain, si la data doit venir enrichir des modèles de prévision d'audience ou les données d'audience tout simplement, il va falloir qu'on s'intéresse vraiment à harmoniser tout ça avec le CIM et sans doute à refixer des nouvelles métriques, des règles bien précises et des définitions qui soient claires, compréhensibles par tout le monde et surtout transparentes. Mmh. Et je crois que c'est un gros boulot qu'on va devoir faire avec le CIM dans le futur.
Meer harmonisatie dus.
Ja.
Tim, jij vertegenwoordigt een aantal commerciële zenders. Wat is u vooral opgevallen of bijgebleven van de buitenlandse collega's?
Ja, voor mij zijn er drie observaties eigenlijk. Hè. Mm-hmm. Enerzijds zien we dat de meting in de ons omringende landen evolueert van single medium naar cross-media of cross-device, cross-platform, hoe je het noemt. Dat is dan vooral gefocust op de content, misschien een beetje minder op de advertising. Dus dat is een interessante leerschool voor ons, voor België. Een tweede punt is dat het is ook vermeld, de Vereniging van Adverteerders komt met een kader in verband met vooral cross-media videometing. En dat zal ook waarschijnlijk zijn impact hebben op België. Eigenlijk is hun punt heel eenvoudig. Ze willen dat elke consument gemeten kan worden, geïdentificeerd kan worden. Die bereikt is via campagne. En anderzijds willen ze ook in kaart brengen hoe frequent dat die bereikt is. Dus eenvoudig gesteld, maar iets moeilijker om te onderzoeken. Mm-hmm. En dat framework wordt nu eigenlijk getest in Amerika en in Engeland. En we zullen zien welke impact dat zal zijn voor België. En een derde punt is de grote mediabedrijven die hun eigen initiatieven nemen om video dan vooral over alle schermen te meten. En dat is dan die fameuze C-Flight in de UK, die overgekomen is van Amerika en ondertussen toch ook adoptie vindt in een aantal Europese landen.
Bernard, vous représentez l'agence Space. Qu'est-ce que vous pouvez ajouter après ce qu'on a entendu?
Après ce qu'on a entendu. Alors deux choses peut-être, seulement deux moi. D'une part, le fait qu'on va devoir désormais réconcilier beaucoup de choses qui paraissaient jusqu'à présent totalement incompatibles entre elles. Mm-hmm. Donc on réconcilie des datas avec des données d'enquête, on va devoir effectivement mêler les méthodes, faire collaborer des instituts entre eux qui jusqu'à présent étaient très concurrents. Donc finalement, l'hybridation va se faire à plein niveau, et ça, ça représente quand même un gros changement. Et alors, justement, on a un changement, mais c'est la deuxième observation, le fait que, comme Johan Smith le disait, donc le reach and frequency va rester le pain et le beurre des agences médias. Pourquoi ? Parce que nos clients nous interrogent toujours sur cette bonne vieille métrique de reach and frequency par média et à travers les médias. Et donc, on a finalement un formidable défi de faire quelque chose de totalement nouveau, tout en maintenant un certain nombre de fondements.
Ik vraag me af, wat zijn eigenlijk de voorbeelden die we gehoord hebben van de buitenlandse collega's die het makkelijkst over te nemen zijn in ons land? Qui commence? Wie eerst?
Ik wil wel inpikken. Ik denk dat geen enkele oplossing echt makkelijk te implementeren is in België. Hè. Ja. We zijn nogal een complex land. Media research is niet zo evident om te realiseren. Maar ik denk een cross-scherm-meting of een cross-media-meting, als we echt mogen dromen van het ideaalbeeld, dat is toch wel de eerste stap om te zetten.
Mm-hmm.
En daar kunnen we natuurlijk een beetje op verder gaan. Het liefst meten we dan niet alleen content, programma's en dergelijke, maar ook advertising, commercieel wel heel belangrijk. En uiteraard doen we dat dan, of willen we dat doen, volgens de huidige principes van goed onderzoek. Dat moet transparant zijn, dat moet kwalitatief zijn, goed uitgevoerd zijn. En met respect voor privacy, als het dan gaat over individuele data. En natuurlijk, sowieso moet dat de confidentialiteit van data ook wel respecteren. Mm-hmm. Dus dat zijn de voorwaarden voor een goede cross-scherm of cross mediameting.
Autre exemple? Iemand anders?
Ik geloof ook heel sterk in de first-party data in België. Omdat België eigenlijk een heel sterk digitaal land is. Heel veel mensen kijken hier digitaal. En wat ook betekent er maar een paar spelers zijn die over die data beschikken. En op die manier zou je eigenlijk in België metingen kunnen opzetten met een paar partijen die die first-party data waar we over gesproken hebben echt kunnen binnenbrengen. Terwijl dat in andere landen de digitalisering toch een stukje achter staat dan op België.
Encore quelqu'un d'autre qui veut ajouter quelque chose?
Peut-être la seule chose, c'est que en fait tout est transposable, les solutions elles sont connues, mais c'est difficilement transposable parce que ça voudrait dire qu'il faut abandonner tout ce qu'on a fait dans le passé. Et évidemment, ça met un petit peu en danger, je parle pour la télé, la radio, les broadcasters qui se disent « Ok, mais on va remettre en cause toutes les parts de marché, les positions acquises par chacun. » Cependant, on est obligé d'aller vers ça et d'aller vers du total audio et vers du total vidéo, c'est clair. Donc, il faudra le faire, mais en essayant de faire ça d'une façon assez douce pour ne pas avoir une cassure avec le passé. Ce qui sera sans doute pas évident à faire, mais...
Oui. We hebben gehoord ook van de Nederlandse collega dat daar het nationaal mediaonderzoek gebeurt met een aantal partijen, een aantal spelers die samen horen te spelen. Jullie doen dat eigenlijk op klein formaat, laat het mij zo zeggen, tussen Ipsos en GFK, voor het SIM-radioonderzoek. Hoe verloopt die samenwerking eigenlijk?
Hier in België op dit moment. Ik denk dat die heel vlot verloopt. Maar het is, zoals jij zegt, het is een beperkte samenwerking. Mm-hmm. Maar ik denk niet dat in de toekomst we minder gaan samenwerken. Ik denk juist dat er meer gaat samengewerkt worden tussen bureaus. Want de hybride oplossingen, de techniciteit enzovoort, zal ervoor zorgen dat we in de toekomst steeds meer gaan samenwerken. En dat moet mogelijk zijn, denk ik.
Ja. Is dat iets wat moet gestimuleerd worden ook, vindt u?
Het wordt gestimuleerd door de markt, zeg maar even. Hè, omdat we sowieso naar een cross-mediale meting gaan. Wat al een gegeven is, wat betekent dat joint industry committees bij elkaar komen in de verschillende landen. Op die manier kan een markt ook de beste assets inkopen van de verschillende bedrijven, zeg maar even. Daar staat natuurlijk tegenover dat er soms efficiëntie is en in een beperkt aantal partijen mee samen te werken. Dus internationaal zie je ook heel veel de twee bewegingen, zeg maar even. Er zijn landen die naar een samenwerking gaan, zoals Nederland. In Zweden zien we met MMS het omgekeerde. En dat hangt echt af van, zeg maar even, de vraag van de markt en van de klant op die moment.
Je crois que l'expérience hollandaise est quand même très difficile à copier parce que elle est tellement c'est un changement tellement important que celui-là est probablement assez difficile à amener ici, quoique. Sinon, effectivement, prendre un exemple existant, par exemple l'anglais, où finalement il y a un focus sur la vidéo, est probablement plus facilement réalisable. Probablement.
Ik denk dat wat Marco zei natuurlijk belangrijk is de breuk met het verleden.
Ja.
Dat een heel belangrijk element is om die innovatie trager te laten gaan dan dat ze misschien technisch mogelijk is.
Mm-hmm. En ligt daar een groot probleem volgens u?
In de technische mogelijkheden niet, denk ik. Het is te zien welke dat je beschouwt. Maar ik denk dat een crossmediale meting op dit moment mogelijk is. De oplossingen zijn ervoor. Maar de weg ernaartoe is heel lang. En zoals dat we gezien hebben in Nederland, begint met de budgettaire context. Dan begint het met de technische context. En dan begint het met het nu in de markt zetten en verkopen en klaar krijgen. Mm-hmm. En ze zijn nog maar begonnen. En inderdaad, waarschijnlijk moet het moeilijkste nog komen. Hè? Ja.
Het is een ingewikkelde operatie. En het is natuurlijk een dure operatie. Ja. Ook omwille van de overgang. En dat er dingen toch een tijd lang in parallel moeten gebeuren. Mm. Dat is een van de schoentjes die wringt, ja.
Ja.
Het maakt me wel bijzonder blij dat er niet meer in vraag gesteld wordt. 5 jaar terug werd crossmediaal in vraag gesteld. Dat is duidelijk ja, we willen naar crossmediaal. Er wordt ook niet in vraag gesteld van moeten we first party data erbij betrekken, ja of nee. Er is alleen een hoe-vraag en een budgettaire vraag. En dat zijn toch wel dingen die me in de markt heel blij maken. Want zoals Gert zegt, technisch is heel veel mogelijk. Maar vaak hangt het af van de partijen in de markt en een joint industry committee, omdat er toch ergens concurrentie altijd met elkaar zit, dat het niet evident maakt. En daar zit denk ik een beetje van, als we er allemaal mee akkoord zijn, maar ja, we moeten vooruit. En dat maakt me heel blij, omdat ik dan weet dat er mogelijkheden er gaan komen in de toekomst.
Kunnen er bepaalde initiatieven worden genomen om dat proces te bewerkstelligen?
Ja. Ik wou misschien even inpikken op een bepaald initiatief. Er is een geweldige window of opportunity, denk ik, omdat de Vlaamse overheid een relancefonds heeft gelanceerd in Vlaanderen, in de naaste.
Het crossmediaal meetsysteem.
Voilà. En daar wordt dus een budget vrijgemaakt, toch een relevant budget, om te investeren in een crossmediale meting die de verschillende belangen samenbrengt en die ook een soort innovatie-investeringsbudget is. Mm-hmm. Maar dat kan wel echt een kickstarter zijn voor wat we willen doen. Want opnieuw, die middelen zijn niet zo evident in een klein land als België. Dus dat is een geweldige opportuniteit, denk ik.
Quelles sont en fait vos attentes au niveau du CIM dans ce contexte? Comment le CIM, après ses 50 ans, devrait évoluer?
La mission du CIM, elle est claire. Hein. Je pense qu'elle n'a pas changé. C'est d'être le garant de la qualité, de la fiabilité des données d'audience. OK, ça, ça ne change pas. Sauf que cette mission, peut-être qu'avant, elle était assez facile à remplir, je dirais. Quand je dis avant, c'est quand les médias étaient organisés en silos, tout à fait indépendants. Alors aujourd'hui, c'est un petit peu plus complexe et c'est un gros défi pour le CIM parce qu'il y a de plus en plus, évidemment, ce mouvement du linéaire vers du non-linéaire. Pardon. Ça s'est fortement accéléré, hein. Ils l'ont pas mal dit tout à l'heure aussi, les internationaux. Ça s'est pas mal accéléré ces deux dernières années avec le Covid. Et donc aujourd'hui, gros défi, c'est d'arriver à faire cette mesure total audio, total vidéo, total presse. Et je pense que c'est la première chose qu'on attend du CIM dans le futur, c'est de mettre enfin en place, avec nous, hein, parce que le CIM c'est nous tous, hein, de mettre enfin en place ces mesures total audio et total vidéo, premier gros défi. Et le second gros défi, c'est celui dont je parlais tout à l'heure, comme ça va être des mesures hybrides, il faudra vraiment qu'on mette le focus sur la qualité de la data, de comment l'harmoniser, comment bien la calculer. Mm-hmm. Sinon, on va faire un mix de données qui sont peut-être pas maîtrisées.
Mm-hmm. Tim, ik weet niet of jij daarmee akkoord gaat, waarschijnlijk wel.
Absoluut,
maar of nog iets aan toegevoegd?
Ja, ik wil nog wel iets aan toevoegen. We mogen niet vergeten dat het CIM nog altijd staat voor grotendeels die offline media, die de currency maken en die het moeilijk maken trouwens om die zomaar te veranderen. Ja. Dus dat bepaalt eigenlijk wat er gekocht en verkocht wordt in ons medialandschap. Mm-hmm. Dat vertegenwoordigt nog altijd ongeveer 50% van de headspendings. En dus, die studies moeten nog altijd gebeuren. Het moet nog altijd kwalitatief, betrouwbaar, transparant gebeuren. Dat is de garantie voor een efficiënte organisatie van de mediameting eigenlijk. Dus daar willen wij op zijn minst dat het CIM toch nog eens 50 jaar op doorgaat. Maar dan is het inderdaad de constructie van die hybride nieuwe meting. Want het CIM moet een rol krijgen in ons digitaal ecosysteem voor de toekomst. We weten dat digitaal groeit, offline media gaan naar beneden. Dus dat is de uitdaging. En dat vraagt natuurlijk ook het noodzakelijke debat om tot die use cases te komen. En ik denk dat die er absoluut zijn. Het zal een soort hybride meetsysteem zijn, waarbij dat zeker bij de start van een commerciële campagne en bij de evaluatie van een campagne, het uniek identificeren van mensen, hoe vaak zijn ze blootgesteld, dat zijn uitdagingen waar ik zeker van ben dat het CIM een rol in kan spelen.
De toekomst van CIM, hoe zien jullie die?
Het leuke aan CIM, denk ik, is dat CIM altijd een crossmediale jig geweest is. Ja. Dus als we naar Nederland kijken, moesten jigs bij elkaar komen. Dat moet in België voor een stukje minder. Ik denk dat het ook, en dat was een beetje ook wat Bernard zegt, uiteindelijk doe je zaken voor de markt en wat heeft de markt nodig. En we zien natuurlijk allemaal de concurrentie van GAFA's binnenkomen. En de vraag is een beetje van hoe ga je als lokale media samenwerken om die lokale media eigenlijk sterker te maken op dat vlak. Mm. En een vraag die natuurlijk op een dag op het CIM-tafel zal liggen is van ja, gaan we de GAFA's erin betrekken, ja of nee? En hoe gaat dat werken als we een volledig ecosysteem willen hebben?
Ja, daar hebben we het in een vorig debat ook al over gehad. Ik weet niet of jij nog iets wilt toevoegen.
Ja, er werd vaak gesproken over de toekomstige rol van het CIM, die het zou bestaan uit het valideren van externe data enzovoort. Ik denk dat dat altijd een beetje de rol van het CIM geweest is, het valideren en de kwaliteit garanderen. En ik denk dat dat een superbelangrijke rol, en zo nodig, zoals dat Marco zegt, nog belangrijker gaat worden in de toekomst. Want met fusie en allerlei datatechnieken, het is allemaal ook zeer gemakkelijk gezegd. Ja, we zullen even fuseren. En dan zien wat eruit komt. Hè. Dus ik denk dat er daar een superbelangrijke rol ligt. Maar inderdaad, de skills die dan nodig zijn, zijn vaak andere dan er in veel jigs vandaag de dag ter beschikking zijn. En ook bij veel van ons, denk ik.
Bernard, finalement, comment voyez-vous l'avenir et le rôle du CIM?
Alors, le rôle du CIM, ça a déjà été dit. Effectivement, c'est vraiment le garant de la qualité de ce qu'on fournit au marché. Donc, c'est évidemment le rôle de chien de garde par rapport aux études. C'est probablement aussi un rôle certificateur par rapport à certains flux de données externes, certificateur aussi par rapport à des process. Bref, donc la qualité, mais effectivement déclinée de façon différente. Et je pense qu'ils ont encore beaucoup de boulot, effectivement, pour quelques dizaines d'années.
Beaucoup de boulot, c'est ce que j'ai entendu.
Ja. Ik was mij net aan het bedenken dat de nieuwe directeur van het CIM in 2061 vorige week geboren is.
Ja. Jij bent al zoveel jaar verder aan het kijken. Oké, wil je er nog iets aan toevoegen? Of?
Nee, het doet plezier dat eigenlijk iedereen ongeveer op dezelfde golflengte zit en redelijk goed ziet waar de toekomst ligt. Er is duidelijk sprake van voortschrijdend inzicht. Als ik terugdenk aan alle moeilijke discussies, Stefan verwees er ook naar tot 5 jaar geleden, bijvoorbeeld over crossmedia. Dus we weten waar we nu, we weten waar we naartoe willen. Nu moeten we gewoon vertrekken.
Gaan met die banaan.
Ja.
Oké, hartelijk dank aan mijn 5 panelleden. Merci à nos 5 panélistes pour leur témoignage. Et je vous donne rendez-vous, mesdames et messieurs, demain pour notre 3e débat qui s'appelle Are Sellers Sims Best Friends? Une discussion donc sur ce que représente le Sim pour les vendeurs. Fijn dat u keek en heel graag tot morgen.